And here again, as I said, we see the word wrath and indignation. Also, remember when we read the harvest? We kept reading the harvest, the harvest, the harvest. We're trying to figure out, what is this harvest? Why is there so much harvest? Not only is it the harvest, because remember, harvest of destruction. Not only is it the harvest of all the saints that had already been done, right? Through all of, because we have all been witnessing to one another. We've all been sharing our testimony. We've been making disciples, teaching and preaching and healing. So all of those people are harvested, because remember that even throughout certain parts, up until the wrath, there were people who were allowed to repent, right? They were given time to repent. And the Bible says that the first shall be last and the last shall be first. So even those people who are last, you know, at the final days repenting, they can be included in serving God and being with God if they're truly repentant, right? So there's a great harvest of the saints. And then there's also a harvest of the destruction. Recalling that when we see the mounting, times through the tribulation, remembering that it's like birth pangs, right? Like labor pains, so that they build and build and build and build and build. So in that sense, you can see a harvest because it's collecting, right? Collecting it all together, coming together. And then it comes together in this great culmination and consummation of the ultimate promise of God to destroy evil. So they're receiving that full cup of wrath, that full wine of wrath of God poured out without mixture, right? The full strength. Okay, so in that sense, there's a harvest of collecting. Then there's also the portions of the scripture where we saw the separation, right? The separation of the sheep from the goats. And in this case, it's not good to be a goat. We talked about that before. You know, people talk about goats today, greatest of all time, right? Well, in this case, it's not good to be a goat, because the sheep and the goat are being separated. The sheep go with the Lord, and the goat go to judgment. Then there's, you know, the separation of the wheat and the tares. The wheat being the good part of the harvest, and the tares being like the weeds, right? We know that parable. We've read it. Now we can see, why is there this separation? The wheat from the chaff, the wheat and the tares. And even there, there's a beautiful part of that parable that you see. The Lord says, don't take up the Lord of the farm, of the field. He says, don't take up the tares right now. Wait till they're fully grown, till they fully matured, right? And then separate the tares from the wheat. Because if you take it out too early, you may destroy all that could potentially be the good wheat, right? So just as we see God allowing, and in that story, that beautiful imagery there is that God is allowing, you know, why does God allow these people who are constantly blaspheming, constantly sinning, constantly, you know, turning against him and everyone who is a Christian and so forth and so on? Why do we see this? Because God is allowing, again, his mercy and his love, allowing them to grow up right along with us, right? And there's another part of the scripture says the rain falls on the good and the bad, right? So in that sense of a field of wheat and tares, the rain is falling on all of it. In other words, we're all receiving some portion of maybe some blessings, some, you know, prosperity. The sun is shining. We're all receiving some warmth, right? We're all experiencing the good and the bad, people, the Gentiles and the Jews, so to speak, right? The good and the bad, the evil and the good. But after we all grow up, in other words, after we've come to the fullness of his prophecy, to this end of time, the actual end, the final days, right? That is when the harvest, and when you're separating the wheat from the chaff, you're taking up the wheat, but you're also taking up the chaff or the tares, the weeds. And what does it say in that parable? The weeds go into a pile and they get burnt up. Here again, we're seeing the same thing in the book of Revelation, in the full strength wine of the wrath, the full strength of destruction, the full strength of judgment. Remembering that when we read the seals, the seven seals, and then we read the seven trumpets, and then we read the seven vials. At what point did we talk about? So now we're talking about when. When is the wrath? At what point did we determine that the wrath starts and the tribulation and the great tribulation, right? That interim, that slight little interim time, that overlapping time. At what point did that begin? So let's see if we can look through scripture again to determine when is this happening. So let's first then look at, again, we'll go to 1 Thessalonians 4:16. First Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 16. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, and with the voice of the trumpet, the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. So here again, we're talking about these trumpets, and I hope you had an opportunity to listen to Trumpets, 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 my special edition a few, maybe last week or so. And through there, I discuss trumpets and actually play some sounds so that you're able to hear what the shofar and other trumpets sound like. And we talked about which trumpet and when is this trumpet, right? So here we see when is the time that's before this great wrath. And, you know, there are a lot of people who want to debate, right? Well, is the rapture, you know, does the rapture happen, before the tribulation, so that we don't experience any suffering, turmoil, trials? And as I described to you before, what the definition of tribulation is, and it's suffering, it's pestilence, it's persecution. So we can't say that none of us, any of us now, are not experiencing some degree of persecution, suffering, or even pestilence and plagues. I mean, right now we're in one, right? The epidemic of this virus. And of course, we have read that there'll be many more plagues and many more famines and so forth and so on. But those, as Jesus said, were just the beginning of sorrows. Now, so if Christians, if followers of Christ, if the saints, if the elect were not going to experience any tribulation, then none of us should be here at this point, assuming that we are found in the book of life, right? So we should not be experiencing any tribulation. But as I described to you, there's a tribulation, and then there is the great tribulation that the Bible spoke of. So let's look back a couple of verses, first of all, here, because we're needing to make sure that we understand, is this what is being spoken of? Because in verse 15, it says, "For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. So again, we know that we're talking about a certain time when the Lord is coming. And then it goes on to say, as we read, for the Lord himself shall descend. Now he's descending now, right? From heaven. And it's important to kind of keep note of that, because many times we overlook words that actually are significant. There are times when Jesus is ascending and then times when he is descending, which is why we're going to be looking at how many times did Jesus actually come? How many times did the Messiah actually come? Right? So we'll be keen to look at some of those words. So he's coming, descending from heaven with a shout and the voice of the archangel and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. So we talked about that at length, I think, a couple of weeks ago. Now let's look at 1 Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 10. And it reads from the King James, and to wait for his son from heaven, who he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from, wait for it, the wrath to come. Jesus coming, who he raised from the dead, which delivered, notice it's past tense here, which delivered us from the wrath to come, which delivered us from the wrath to come. So why is it past tense here? Because it's talking about once we have been raised with Christ, caught up in the air, then we would have been delivered at that point, right, from the wrath that will be coming. So now we know that at the very least, this rapture time is just before, or happening before, prior to, sometime before the wrath to come, right? Because we will have been delivered. Now we're trying to, you know, again, trying to pinpoint when is this time. Let's look at also 1 Thessalonians, going over to chapter 5. And verse 9. And again, we can confirm, for God has not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus. Ha! Huh. So there's something interesting here. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake, whether we are alive, right, and remain, or we're asleep and dead, we should live together with him. So here is an interesting little tidbit, right? If we are not appointed to wrath, but to obtain salvation, when did you obtain your salvation? Now, of course, you know, this is another hot topic. People debate about, you know, once saved, always saved. Well, that's not a really true doctrine, but we'll get into that at some other time. And if you have been looking at any of the Truth Unedited videos, I think he recently did a video on that subject. I think maybe it was his latest video, in fact. But at any rate, we'll discuss that at some other time. But when you received your salvation, when you declared, whether privately or publicly, that you were going to serve the Lord, when you were going to receive him into your life, when you were going to obey his commands, when you were going to repent of your old habits and sinful ways, and